The slide is visible.
Yes, ma'am.
One second. So how it is visible? Is it like next slide also is it's visible? Huh?
Yes, ma'am.
So how about now?
Just sling the slide.
Pardon?
Yeah, it's visible a single slide.
Yeah, slide okay. That next slide, notes, everything is coming. Or slides alone? No. Okay.
Slides alone.
Next is about the payment material. So first about subgrade and aggregate. So subgrade, so most of you or it's not you will be studying more in geotechnical engineering. Anyway, I'll take some portion which is very much relevant to the pavement or transportation. Okay. So this already we have seen, it's a road composition. So from the ground level, above that you have embankment, subgrade, subbase, base course, and your surface or wearing course. And if it's a flexible pavement, this is a pattern of load distribution. So what it is given here. So soil as construction material. So soil. So what do you mean by soil? Like it's a mineral matter formed by disintegration of rocks. Okay, it can be due to the action of water, frost, temperature, etc. Those things. And all whatever the load coming, everything is basically it's finally it's coming to the subgrade. Okay, so it's a part of the road pavement. And soil is used as fill material for embankments in its natural form, gravel or sand. Embankment, you know, if you want to raise the height of the road, so you have to fill it. So that filling is with soil. Then other in its natural form means gravel or sand. Earlier, like for subbase and all, we were using instead of using aggregates, we were using this gravel sand mixture as subbase course. Okay, or it can be in the form of this processed base or subbase also, along with mixing gravel with some aggregates and or something or as such also, if you feel like it's a good gravel can be used. So what is the type of soil? So what are its properties? Everything is important in selecting the impactment material. Okay. It's don't think that it's just you have to dump the material. You can dump any material, whatever you want. It should also, because you have to dump it, it should be compacted properly in the impactment also. So you should know what is the properties of the material, even though it's for a dumping also in case of impactment. Then you have to know the properties of soil for designing the pavement, especially in the difference of flexible and rigid pavement. You have seen that in case of flexible, the dependence of the subgrade soil is very much there in flexible pavement, because flexible the properties of subgrade is very important, or this properties, the material properties mainly is what you have to consider for the design of pavement as E and mu value, that is your elastic modulus value and the Poisson's ratio value. Okay, for elastic modulus value, you have to know the elastic modulus and Poisson's ratio value of the subgrade soil. And elastic modulus, it can be you can get the soil or E value of the soil from the triaxial test. I don't know if you have studied that or not. Triaxial test, it's an experiment where you can find the E value. If not, some other field test, or it can be correlated. It's not easy to do the triaxial test. So what actually, if it is it's done for, if it's not a major work and all, so what we used to do is, it's you can find the CBR value. It's California Bearing Ratio test, which can be found out comparatively easier than the triaxial test. So you find the CBR value. Even in IRC code, which is for the flexible pavement, there is the correlation between the CBR and the elastic modulus of the soil is given. So you can find the CBR value and find the E value of the soil from that, which has to be used for the design. In earlier code and all, in earlier IRC code or the earlier in long back, the design of flexible pavement was based only on the properties of the subgrade and on the traffic. Okay, so here the inflexible, the properties of subgrade is very much important. So to know the soil properties is very much needed. Then drainage system. Drainage system, it's not can be a separate drainage system. Otherwise, like soil subbase, no, subbase layer. One of the property of the subbase layer is to have drainage. So you should know the properties of how drainage proper, this property means whether the water is able to flow over this. What is the permeability of the material or soil which you are using in that layer? It's not only for that, even for subgrade also it's needed, right? Then other one, the supporting soil beneath the pavement and its special undercourses is called subgrade. So what is that? Whatever the finally your base or subbase, subbase, base, or the stop, everything is coming on the, it's laid on the this soil course, which is called the subgrade. Okay. So undisturbed soil beneath the pavement is called natural subgrade. If you are not, if you didn't do anything as such, it's natural, above the natural soil, if you're just laying it, then that layer is called natural subgrade. Okay. Compacted subgrade means it can be, is the soil compacted by controlled movement of heavy compactors. Controlled movement means that depends on the type of the soil. Say suppose if you have a clay and like gravel, the number of passes you have to roll the rollers is different. The weight with which you have to roll the soil is different. That's why it's called controlled movement, because the number of passes, the weight, then frequency, all this, if it is a vibratory roller, this frequency, amplitude, everything is controlled. Okay, that layer, if you're compacting such way, it's called compacted subgrade. Okay, if it is not disturbed, then it's natural subgrade. And you have to compact at least like 30 to 50 centimeter soil should be well compacted before laying the road. it's a subgrade soils. Above that, they have played a geosynthetic system. It can be treated. You can have a layer over there to improve the. So the function and significance of subgrade properties. So it's a basement soil of roadbed. It's important for the structural and the pavement life. No, finally, its structure, your entire structure is levied on this subgrade. So it's important. It's an important part of the structure to improve the structural and pavement life. And it should not deflect excessively due to the dynamic loading of the vehicles. And your pavement, it can be either in a fill or embankment and compacted or natural subgrade. So it can be either in a cut and fill. I have informed you what is the pros and cons of both this. No, in cut at a portion, like maybe you need not dump any pouring material and all. The other problem with this is drainage, especially during rainy season, and also if the water table level is very high, drainage is crucial there. Okay, typical cut section. You might have seen this problem, some underpasses or underways, you can see the lot of water will get stagnated there, especially during drainage, if proper drainage facilities is not given. Okay. Other one is embankment. Embankment, it's good even if you're, you might have seen like in a national highways, you can see if it's a dual lane road. I mean, for A to B and B, B to A, both direction, the level of the road will be at different height. Can you tell me what is the use of this? Whether you got my question, same road at different level. Okay, one direction at lower, other direction at embankment. One direction may be at natural subgrade level, other direction road will be on a higher level. What is the benefit of this? Pardon?
At night times, it will be beneficial, like the headlights of the vehicles will be highly focused.
Yeah, highly, because you will not get interference with the head, this opposite vehicle. Otherwise, you can see if it is a single lane road, if you're traveling during night, can see how nuisance or how difficult this visibility problem. You don't know if a truck is coming, you won't be sure like it's a truck or a two-wheeler or some other vehicle. It's very difficult, okay? And the glare at a problem, all this will be there. You can avoid these things. Okay. So embankment, the problem, it's good to have embankment. Other thing is you should have a lot of material to dump over there. Other one is slope stability. You should check extra design thing. You should check for this stability of the slope in case of if it is embankment. One second. What? Malaki? Sorry, students. So either your cut and fill, so both are having its pros and cons. Next is the subgrade soil. Can be of different types like granular or can be coarse grained soil, fine grained soil, organic soil also. There are some soil categories which is not suitable for subgrade material. Say like if it's a clay soil which contains a higher value of liquid limit is more than 80% or the plasticity index value is more than 55% and all, it's not suitable for the of subgrade soil. Okay, then other one, if it is an flammable material, soily or organically clay soil which contain lots of rotten roots, grass or other vegetations, it's not suitable. And other one, soil which is soft and unstable because it's too wet or dry, which makes it difficult to compact. And if it's very soft and unstable, so it is not suitable. So these type of soil is not suitable for as a subgrade material. These properties I've already explained, the desirable properties, it should have stability, incompressibility. There should be only minimum changes in volume and stability under adverse condition of weather and groundwater. Then permanency of strength. Okay? Strength should not change afterwards. It should be stable, or the strength should be permanent. Good drainage properties it should have. It should be ease for compaction. So soil types, I will just brush up over this. Soil types, there are wide range of soil types that broadly can be categorized like laterite soil, loam, red soil, desert sand, alluvial soil, clay, including blackout. And these terms you might have seen, heard, right? So soil, as per IS, if it is a gravel, if the size is between 75 mm to 4.75 mm, it can be classified as gravel. Sand from 4.75 to 75 micron or 0.075 mm, it's called sand. Again, in this coarse grain, medium grain, fine grained sand is there depending on the size. Like coarse grain sand means 4.75 to 2. 2 to 0.475 mm is medium, 0.475 mm to 75 micron is fine grain sand. Then silt is 75 micron to 2 micron, clay is even lesser than 2 micron. So with the size itself, you can classify the soil. Then before the construction of road or survey, you have to know the properties of soil. Okay. So getting the soil sample is very important. It's important for the construction of buildings and also for the construction of roads also. Okay. So the main objective of the soil survey is to find what type of soil you have. Okay. Along the alignment, if the road is 50 kilometer or 100 kilometer, it's not enough. If you're taking at least 40 kilometer, you should take a sample. Or wherever the soil profile changes, you have to take some sample for testing. Okay. And soil sampling at an interval of 200 mm or wherever its profile changes is important. And soil samples to be evaluated for different geotechnical properties. Types of soil is already mentioned. Other is index properties of soil. So what do you mean by index properties?
Specific gravity and all that properties.
Yeah, specific gravity, all that. What is that? Well, index properties means, I'm not asking what all properties, what do you mean by that?
That is for fixed defined of
amount of properties. You can define
define, you have to tell what type of soil it is, right? You have to define what type of soil. For that you require at least these tests like grain size analysis, liquid limit, plastic limit, and also grain size means wet sieve analysis is applicable for all type of soil. Wet sieve analysis can be done, and sieve analysis for the particle sizes more than 75 micron, you can do the sieve analysis. Okay, mechanical shaker or manual shaker, this is the this mechanical shaker, or it can be done at manually also, can be used. Sedimentation analysis, you have studied this hydrometer, pipette analysis and all this. It's for if the soil particle is less than 75 micron, then you have to use the hydrometer analysis for finding the properties. So coarse grained soil by sieve analysis can be done. For fine grained soils, if that, especially if the size is less than 75 micron, it should be through this hydrometer analysis. Then free swell, these are other properties. Free swell index. Swell index means it's an expansive quantity, especially this for clay and all. clay, we have seen, once if you are mixing clay, if you are finding the volume, and the moment you are mixing it with the clay, its volume increases, it will start swelling. So you have to know what is a swell, and there is a limit for a swelling percentage also. So it indicates the expansive qualities of soil. It gives the amount of volume increase of soil on coming in contact with water. Okay. Then liquid limit, it's a percentage of water content at which the soil enters in liquid state. So all of you have studied all this liquid limit, plastic limit. In geotechnical, is this portion being covered?
Yes, ma'am.
This liquid limit, the water content at which the soil enters liquid state, plastic limit from whenever it enters to plastic state. Liquid limit minus plastic limit is plasticity index. Okay, even though it's geotechnical, this thing, as far as pavement is considered, we are also bothered about these properties. Okay. Then define, like, how will you define whether it's a sand or gravel? And also sand and gravel, these are cohesionless aggregates. Okay, this it's not, say if you're taking a clay and all, these are cohesive material. If you are just mixing it soil, you can see the difference. No, sand or gravel, these are cohesionless aggregates. Of angular, subangular, it can be of anything, roundy, flaky, or any material. So gravel is means 80 mm to 4.75. Sand means between 4.75 to 75 micron. Okay, for that you have to do the grain size analysis, and you might have studied this curve. No, this is curve for sieve analysis. So what do you mean by this uniform, gap graded, and well graded? So let's tell about this uniform grading. What do you mean by that? Uniform grading.
All the sizes are present in good
proportions. All the sizes are
present in good proportions.
Present in good proportion in which grade? Uniform or well graded?
In well graded,
all the proportions uniform are there in correct shape. The uniform graded means
similar diameter.
Similar. I mean, same one aggregate type of more quantity or same size. And what about gap graded? Gap graded means even though like different size of particles are there, but some particle alone will be missing. It won't be a smooth S curve. You can see the shape, right? Gap graded, some gap or some particles will be missing. Okay, that's gap graded. So see, this curve you will get after doing. I'm not going in detail into it. Might have already studied. So other, so with this you will get whether your the soil what you're having is well graded, poorly graded, or gap graded and all. This coefficient of uniformity can just find out from this D10. Hope everybody knows that D10, D30, D60, right? Cu, cc values. Cu is D60 by D10, cc is D30 square by D10 into D60. Again, with this also, you can categorize the soil. If your CU values between 2 or 3, it is poorly graded soil. For well-graded soil, it will be 15 or more than that. Applications of this test is, it's for soil classification. You can get the pattern of the soil size distribution. Pattern means you will get how, whether it says shape, it's poorly graded or well-graded, and all you can get. Then proportioning the soils for mixed design, for designing or proportioning the material, what should be the quantity of this material, that if you wanted to mix two or three material, you have to know the size of the particular material. For that also it will help. The next test is liquid limit. So which step is plasticity is an important property of clay soil. Okay, So there's a minimum moisture content at which the soil will flow when subjected to very small shearing force. And what's the apparatus used for that to find the liquid limit? Yeah, it's Atterberg's limit, that's Cassegrande's apparatus. Okay, or you can use cone penetrometer. So soil, if having a high liquid limit value, it's not suitable for embankment material and even for as subgravel. So this is Cassegrande's liquid limit apparatus. Maybe whenever you are back to campus, you can see it in the lab. Okay, geotechnical lab and transportation lab also we have this Cassegrande's liquid limit apparatus. So hope the procedure also familiar. I'll just brush up. So this you need to have a soil passing hot 25 micron. Then in this cup, so here in this portion you have to keep the sample. Okay, then adjust the free fall of cup to 10 mm. Then the maximum depth of soil paste in the cup is 10 mm, and divide the soil in the cup. No, you can just have a groove over this. Okay, this is the divided soil cake. You have to first put a groove over this, then rotate this. You have to rotate it, and you're finding what is the number of blows required to close this groove. Okay, and the water content, the corresponding water content you have to know. In the draw the curve between the number of blows and the various water, and similarly like increase the water content. Sometimes if the water content is small, then you require only very less number of blows. No, with that itself it will close. So plot a graph between the this moisture content or the water content and the number of blows in semi log scale. Then the water content corresponding to 25 number of blows is noted as liquid limit. Okay, next one, plastic limit. It's the moist minimum moisture content at which the soil mass remains in plastic state. So in this, what you're doing is you are rolling the soil into a thread of 3 mm, and so the soil, the procedure continued till the thread crumble at a diameter of 3 mm. That water content is noted as plastic limit, right? So I'm just brushing up. Hope everybody knew this because it's already tested it in geotechnical. If something is new to you, you can stop me. I'll explain in detail. So the plasticity index is liquid limit minus plastic limit. For the construction of roadwork, for earthwork, the liquid limit should be less than 70, and the plasticity index, PI is plasticity index value, should be less than 45. Okay, that's why you're finding the property. So whenever you're getting a material for earthwork, so you should check whether its liquid limit value is less than 70 and the PI value is less than 45. For a material to be used in subbase, the liquid limit value should be less than 25 and the PA value should be less than 6. For a binding material in WBM, I'll tell you what is a binding material. WBM, water bound macadam, or WMO, wet mix macadam. The PA material should be, PA value should be less than 6. Other is soil compaction. Why do you need to compact the soil? What is the need for compaction of soil? Everywhere you have seen, or whenever the road is constructed, used to compact, the soil compaction is very important. Why are you doing this?
I'm so dead air.
It may settle after loading.
It will better take the load, then it can increase the density. It will, the air voids or volume of air, as you mentioned, it will get reduced. So you can improve the properties, especially the density, and with that the other properties also will get improved, right? So you're defining like it's a process of increasing the density of soil by packing the particles closer together with the reduction in the volume of air. You are just making the particles closely. That's why your density is increasing. So it can be how much you have compacted, it can be measured based on the density of the soil. So its need for compaction is this will increase the strength, right? It will increase the strength of the soil. If you are just taking a material or having laying a road in compacted on a non-compacted soil, definitely if you are not compacting the soil, then what will happen is if you are laying the road, after that it will start keeping on compacting. It's not compacting, it's a way of consolidation will take place. Then the road will get collapsed. So it's very important to compact the soil before laying the road. So this will increase the strength. This will reduce the compressibility of the soil because already it's compacted. Otherwise, what will happen when the vehicle starts moving, it's keep on, volume will get compressed. Okay, then reduction in tendency for subsequent changes in moisture content also, it will reduce. Then reduction in erodibility of the soil, reduction in frost susceptibility. The, for these reasons, you need to compact the soil. What are the types of compaction? Like laboratory techniques of like static compaction, dynamic or impact. Static means what? We have a static load. No, it's not vibratory. Hope you understood. It's a static load with dynamic or impact compaction. Impact load means you are just making, if you are just dropping a stone or a weight from a height, that's an impact load. Okay. Or it can be with a kneading. There's a kneading example like you have seen compacting the concrete and all, no, with a kneading, right? Then vibratory roller, where it will to vibrate. So vibratory compaction, many times. So usually static or dynamic compaction is adapted in the laboratory when I'll tell. So comparison between static and dynamic compaction, which is good actually? To go for a static or a dynamic compaction in the field, I'm telling, or in the lab also, which is better, which will give more which is more effective, or which will give more density in static or dynamic compaction?
Dynamic.
Huh? Dynamic compaction, right? Or if it is like vibratory compaction. But one thing you remember, then you may ask like why it is static is used. Okay, if that's coming in your pavement construction portion, even after doing so many this vibratory compaction, you may have to roll this with static compactor to have a smooth this finish. No. Or for the top surface, you require static compactor is also required. So standard and modified Proctor compaction. This Proctor compaction test is for what? You have studied this maximum dry density and optimum moisture content. Do you remember this curve? Say yes or no. It's not taught. Yes, right. So this is where you have to draw a curve between dry density and moisture content. What for actually you're doing? You're finding what is the maximum density you can achieve for that particular type of soil, right? What is the maximum density? If you're say I'm compacting a soil, I have added some quantity of water. So what will happen if I'm adding more quantity of water, whether the density will increase or decrease? If I'm adding more quantity of water to the soil and compacting, whether the density of the soil will increase or decrease? What will happen? Initially, what will happen? I'm starting from zero. bare soil, there's no moisture. I'm adding 2%. What will happen? It will improve the density, right? You just take the this lowest curve, this for standard Proctor. This will improve the. So if I'm adding like water, at some point it will keep on increasing the density. It will reach a peak point. Then again, if you are increasing the water content, the density will get decreased. Okay. So the maximum moisture, the maximum density with which you can attain the for that particular type of soil is called the maximum dry density, and the water content at which you can attain this maximum dry density is called the optimum moisture content. Okay. The Proctor test, it can be done with standard Proctor and modified Proctor. In that one, like the mold is different. That is mold with which you have to do the mold is different. Sometimes you can use a different hammer also. Okay, different hammer also can be used for this. If you are using the same hammer, then you should change the number of blows and the height with which it has to be, or number of layers and the number of blows. So the comparison between standard and Proctor compaction, the soil with which you have to take is same, and the number of blows have to give for the soil is different. If it is Proctor, give three layers with 25 blows. For this modified one, you give 5 layers with 25 or 55. Why it's given 25 or 55? That depends on the weight of the hammer. Okay. So soil compaction by, if it is 2.6 kilogram hammer for standard Proctor, the height of the fall is 31. For modified, it should be based on 4.9 kilogram hammer with a height of 45 centimeter. Okay. The standard Proctor test, it's usually adopted if the roads are for this low volume rural roads or for village roads and all, you can use this. Or for small this residential streets can be adopted. As for rural road specification, you can go for this standard Proctor. Modified Proctor is as per the more specification. That's for national highways, state highways, then major district road, arterial roads, etc. Okay. So what is this MORTH and all? It will be dealt in your first unit. MORTH is some specifications are levied by the MORTH or Ministry of Roads and Transport. Okay. And now it's different. Different versions are there, like revision 1, 2, 3, 4, etc. is there. So what are its purview? It will be studying in your first unit. And similarly with the IRC and all. Okay. This OMC and MDD curve for the standard and modified Proctor. So modified standard, so same soil, if you are testing it with a standard Proctor and modified Proctor, what will happen is yours. This is with the first curve, the bottom curve is with standard Proctor test, the top one is with modified Proctor test. So when you are improving, or if you are increasing the weight of this hammer or the number of blows, what will happen is the moisture content at which you can attain the maximum dry density will get reduced, and the maximum dry density is increasing. Okay, with the standard and the modified Proctor test, the maximum dry density will get increased, okay, and the moisture content, optimum moisture content, decrease. Got it. So that's with standard. So that depends on the road is used for, whether it's for national highway or a village road. Depending on that, this moisture content, you can choose on standard and modified moisture content. Next is measurement of dry density in the field. Field, how will you, this Proctor test is conducted in the laboratory. Laboratory, you are finding what is the maximum dry density of the soil, Actually, why do you want to find this maximum dry density of the soil? In the field, actually, you should check whether you're able to attain this maximum dry density or not. Okay. You have to know in the field with which water content you have to mix. You can't just pour the water as such, because it's beyond OMC, your density will get decreased. Right. So you have to know what's the optimum moisture content with which you can mix the soil in the field also. Field, the problem with the field is you might not be able to attain the same density as you can attain in the lab. Your aim is to attain the maximum dry density in the field. In the field, you have to check whether you have attained that maximum density or not. That can be tested using your sand replacement method or using pore cutter method. I'll just explain these two in next class. Okay, so this sand replacement method and pore cutter method, these are done in the field to check whether the soil is compacted to the maximum dry density or not. Okay. Any doubt in this topic? Okay, if not, I'm just winding up. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you all.
Thank you, ma'am.
Yes. Thank you.